We focus on autonomous systems, but a lot of the technology that's available could be on systems that aren't autonomous. They could be semi-autonomous or even systems that are piloted. But let's take a look and see what the challenge really looks like. This is what a typical scene looks like, and you know, this is going down the street here, and the first portion of this is really looking at the sense, right? What do the sensors see in this scene? And as we put that together, we want to also look and see not only what the sensors see, but we want to focus on perception, because we want to look at intent, right? And the picture here is the sensors are detecting things, but we want to know intent. Is the person going to walk out in front of the vehicle, right? So it's looking at identifying what's in the scene and also trying to get some sense of what's happening here. And once we put that together, we need to be able to figure out what the next steps are. The decide and plan portion, you know, what does the autonomous system actually do next? And then actually acting on that system, right? So we can look and see what the autonomous system actually does. Now, a lot of my examples will be in automated driving, but a lot of what I show here will be applicable across the board for other autonomous systems. So that's just a quick background here. Let's go into a little bit more detail. I'll give you the quick introduction, and then we'll talk about the technology that we have for perception, namely around sensor fusion and tracking. We'll also look at some of the algorithms that are available for you for development. And I'll answer some questions and also show you some areas to resources you can use to get started quickly. Okay. So for us, when we talk about sensor fusion and tracking, we're really talking about two things. Self-awareness, that is, what is the platform doing? Its position, orientation, pose. We look at sensors like inertial measurement units and altimeters and GPS as the inputs that help determine that position and orientation. And the other side, the situational awareness side, is really looking at what's going on around the system, right? These are sensors like LiDAR, radar, camera, EOIR, sensors like that that are looking, again, external to the platform. And really where sensor fusion and tracking comes in, the reason we're so excited about it is that it really bridges these domains that MathWorks has been strong in, from on one side, the signal and image processing, and the other side, the controls domain, right? So it's really helping bridging those domains and closing the loop. And sensor fusion and tracking toolbox was something we introduced in 2018B, and it's continued to evolve since then with each of the releases. Now, let's look at a simple example, and I'll show you some more results of simulation. What do we mean by sensor fusion? For fusion, we're really talking about the idea of taking sensor measurements and combining the strengths of those sensor measurements to get an answer that will be better than if we look at any individual one sensor. Okay, so that's kind of the basic thing. Let's take a look at it from a camera and radar standpoint. We start with what the measurement and the prediction that we had at the previous time step. And the next thing that we'll do is we'll predict ahead to the time step that's coming, right? We have some idea of what the motion is of the system that we're tracking, and we project ahead in time. The next thing that we do is we get measurements from the sensors, and each of the sensors will have their own strengths and weaknesses. In this case, we use a radar and a camera as an example to show how the measurements vary, right? One sensor is better in one dimension, maybe the other sensor is better in the other dimension. The idea with sensor fusion is that when we combine those, we get an answer that's better than the individual sensors, okay? So that's just a quick view there. Now, before we start into looking at what's going on around the system, we wanna look at what the system's doing. And for this, we wanna look at what localization is, right? So for localization, we think of three reference frames that we want to work in. One is the sensor orientation itself. We refer to that as a sensor frame. That sensor or sensors can be mounted onto a platform. So the platform also has an orientation. If this was a UAV, for example, the UAV might be traveling in some direction, but maybe it has sensors that are mounted in different locations on the platform, right? So we need to be able to consider that. And then when we put those platforms in motion together, interacting with other platforms, we need to have the concept of a global frame. Okay, so sensor frame, body frame, and global frame. And what you see here is an autonomous driving case where we're going around a racetrack, and notice what the orientation looks like as it's going around. You can see it went over a bump there. We'll go around the corner, you can see the banking of the system. That's an important aspect because we'll have sensors that will be looking outwards from the vehicle. And we need to know if we have a narrow radar beam or a camera pointing in a certain direction, it's important to be able to understand and model and see how we're going to do this. And I'll show you some sensor models that we have to model these kinds of sensors, but you can also take your own data from your own hardware systems as well. I want to show you an example of how sensor fusion can be used to improve localization. In this example, what we have is a comparison of ground truth with our estimated position. And what's nice about this is you can model the sensors, things like IMU, accelerometer, gyro, magnetometer, as well as GPS. And in that middle column, it might be hard to see in the back there, but there's basically checkboxes where I can shut off individual sensors and see the impact that that sensor has on sensor fusion. GPS is going to give the biggest difference. If I shut off GPS and I'm only using IMU, I'll get a wide divergence in the ground truth. The other ones are more subtle, but the key thing is you have a framework to explore things like sample update rates from each of the sensors, or should I spend additional money to get a better IMU sensor, for example. And you can have that kind of exploration before you even architect your system or decide which IMU components you're going to use or how GPS is going to be integrated in the system. As common, you'll see in all the examples I show here, you have integrated metrics that you can use to compare the results of your answer to the ground truth. Okay? Now, so you may not have ground truth in the real system, but the nice thing about simulation is you can create scenarios that concern you, that are corner cases in your system, and see how the system performs in that before you build your system and architect your system. Self-awareness is important in the bigger picture because you can't understand situational awareness unless you understand the platform's self-awareness, right? So in this case, we're taking data from data that we take from a quadcopter. After it's flown, we use that, download the data in MATLAB and Simulink, and use that as the ground truth to feed our sensor models to generate the scenario. And what you see on the top is the ground truth, and the bottom, again, is the estimated using the fusion algorithms we have. So we have sensor models to generate the data as if it came from the flying quadcopter in this case, as well as the algorithms that are used to fuse that data, right? So it can tell how well it's performing, again, before you actually go out and build the system. Now, once we have a good picture of what we mean by self-awareness, we can then look at a broader framework to figure out what the situational awareness piece is going to be. And for this, the basic workflow is shown here, where we have the option to take in recorded data. So you might have your own sensor data that you take off your own hardware, as well as the case where you use the sensor models that we have to generate the data as if it was coming from the systems that we're building. Okay? Now, the key thing here is that you can... we have some folks that have lots of their own data, and some customers have no data at all to start with. And some like the idea of actually doing a mix, being able to augment your actual data from your system with data that, again, focuses on those corner cases that you can see, that you worry about, that are going to drive the performance of your system. Now, whether you use our sensor models or whether you use data that you've actually collected from your own sensors, the common thread here is that the interface into our algorithms, our tracking algorithms and our localization algorithms, go to a common interface. We refer to, in the case of the sensors like radar and LiDAR, is our object detection format. And if you use our sensor models, it gets generated in that format and everything downstream is digested directly. If you have your own sensor models and you want to take the data from those sensor models or your own hardware, you can map, it's very easy to map to this object detection format, and the reward for doing that is everything downstream from that object detection format will work. The tracking algorithms will take that data in, as well as the visualization metrics downstream, as well as the code gen capabilities that we have, which you can use to generate C code, for example. The field of view, and the further away from the sensor we get, the more ambiguity is in the measurement. So that's not a problem if we only have one target there. You can see the little red dot there in this cell that's kind of located far away from where the radar is, the tracker can handle that nicely. But what happens when there's more than one object in that cell, in that area there? What happens is ambiguity is created. And consider this case where we have two objects that are coming together. And what you see is it's clear there's two objects to start. But what's hard to tell is, did the objects come together and then go back out where they came from, or did they cross in the system? Now, we generated the ground truth, so we know what the ground truth is. But the question is, you know, did they cross or did they go back out again? Now, the key thing with this is that you can create that scene without ever having the UAV or the platform that has the sensors on it leave the ground or leave the garage or wherever your autonomous system is going. And this is just one example, right? But it's very easy to generate these kinds of scenarios, both interactively with some of our apps that we have, whether it's through automated driving toolbox in the case of ground vehicles, or in the case of systems that move around off the ground. You can use waypoints to create your own trajectories of these complicated scenes, that these corner cases that you want to combinations of tracker types and motion model and tracking filter combinations that will satisfy this or your set of test cases that you've generated, okay? So in this case, it's a little bit hard to see probably in the back, but on the left, we're using the most efficient, in terms of computation, tracker with a very simple motion model, constant velocity model. And that combination, while pleasing from a computation standpoint, results in broken tracks. It's probably hard to see there, but right when these guys come together, the tracker actually drops the track. And not only that, but with the motion model that's used in Mavic Connect, we have a crossing, which wasn't actually what happened in the ground truth. So with a couple of lines of code, in this case, one line of code and one parameter, we're able to swap out the tracker, keep everything else identical in the scenario, and try different trackers. Now, we can go up in terms of computation intensity and get a better answer, like we do on the right. We can also look across the spectrum of algorithms in the library and figure out which the best algorithm is in this case. And so when we're done, we can balance out which one gives us the answer that's correct based on ground truth for that scenario, and which one is most computationally efficient. And we can find that directly, and the answer comes out. Now, this is a very simple, straightforward case. You could imagine building up a bunch of these corner cases and figuring out which combination is best for your system. Now, that tracker that I just showed you, those three trackers that I showed you were point object trackers. And the basic assumption we have for point object trackers is we assume that we get one detection per measurement per scan. Okay, so in the case of radar, for example, we might be scanning radar, but we're assuming that even if that is a big object that's really close to the sensor, we need to do some work, either in the form of clustering, to reduce that point that collection of points into a single point object, feed that into the tracker, and track that. Now you'll see an example coming up where I can also create a shape and then put that shape into the point object trackers and track the shape. Okay, so that's option two. And the more I move into beyond this point object tracker, really we talk about extended object tracking, right? And so I'll show you a couple of examples of this in the context of automated driving. But this certainly applies to cases that are not autonomous driving systems as well. It could be UAVs with high-resolution sensors that are looking at things in its field of view. The key difference here is that with a high-resolution sensor, we're going to return more than one detection per object per scan. Okay, so that's going to be the difference in the two cases. So the simple case I just showed you where the objects were coming together, that was assumed point object tracking, and it used our series of kind of exercise some of the library of point object trackers you have to pick from. What are the trade-offs? There it's more compute intensity versus better performance under certain conditions. Being able to have multiple hypothesis trackers, for example, or being able to do a better job on some of these corner case scenarios that I talked about. All right, so let's start with a case with a LiDAR sensor. Now this example, I'll show you the video of this, but basically what's happening is we're taking the LiDAR data that's been recorded from a LiDAR sensor. So it shows you don't have to just use our sensor models to generate data. This is actually going to be data that come from an actual scene. I'll show you the scene too, you can see the ground truth. But basically what we have is that system in the middle with the blue around it, that's actually the vehicle with the LiDAR on it. And what we're doing is we're processing that data, removing the ground in that view, and then creating, processing the point cloud to generate a bounding box. The bounding box is a 3D, in this case a 3D bounding box that has length, width, and height on it. And the idea is that the LiDAR sensor is generating a point cloud with high enough resolution that we can actually map that into this bounding box. And we're feeding that into the point track, the point object tracker, as a bounding box in this case, to determine whether we can detect the object or not, and keep track of what's going on around it. Okay, so what you see here in the middle is the scene kind of replaying with the bounding boxes overlaid on top of the ground truth. And on the right side, what we see is the effects of a maneuvering object, in this case, a vehicle. Okay, so that requires some additional complexity in the motion model in the tracking filter that we use here, because we're using something called interactive multiple model tracking filter, which allows the tracker to consider multiple motion models, constant turn, constant velocity, constant acceleration, as an example. And that allows us to, the tracker, to actually follow a maneuvering object. In this case, a car is doing a maneuver. When we're done, we can generate C code. One of the things that's nice about the tracking workflows is there's a lot of control-based code and a lot of bookkeeping. And with MATLAB Coder, we can generate C code and really accelerate the time that's needed to simulate this. So the speed up in simulation is fairly great. And also, of course, once you have C code, you can use it outside MATLAB, whether it's a head start on deployment or using it in a larger simulation framework outside of MATLAB, that's all possible. Up on the top right here, I'll have this at the booth afterwards, so please feel free to come by, but you can see up on the top right, that's the ground truth that's used to generate. That's the camera view of what's happening. Okay? And the LiDAR sensor is actually collecting that data, and you can see the full picture. The bird's eye view on the left, and the top here where the ego vehicle is, where the field of view of the sensor, and then also where the bounding box is versus where the ground truth is of the sensors, right? So I can look at this and put something together and then actually compare the metrics to what I'm seeing versus what I have in the view here. So we're using one of the point object trackers here in this case with the interactive multiple model filter to get the best results in this case, okay? So again, key thing is, we can take data in from a sensor, it doesn't have to be synthesized, and we can track high resolution objects and using the point cloud map to the bounding box, the 3D bounding box. Now, in the case of radar as a sensor, just another example, and this could easily be a camera as an input as well, I could generate a bounding box for a camera as well, but let's look at the radar case. The radar case where we have a high resolution radar in 2D, where the scenario here is that the vehicle has 360-degree coverage from the radar, and the ego vehicle is the blue one in the middle with the coverage that's shown around the sensor. And what happens is, as this plays out, what you can see is, on the right, the vehicles that are in the field of view have multiple detections per object. Okay, and it may be hard to see in the back, but there's a bounding box around that that's basically mapped to the shape of the vehicle. And the important piece of this is that in addition to getting position and velocity of the through the tracker, you actually are now getting something that includes orientation and size. And this can be an important thing. Imagine having motorcycles versus cars versus semis in the same scenario and being able to use that. You can see how that also gives you information about what you're actually looking at. And again, this is an automated driving example, but we have similar examples for things like maybe autonomous systems that would be on the water or things that are flying as well. When we're done, we can look at and compare the different types of tracking options here and get an answer. In this case, lower is better. And what we look at is, we say, well, we have different options. They're all computationally different. What's the system I'm going to implement on? Does it give me the right answer? And I can have that trade space to figure out what size and what compute power I need to have in my end system to actually implement this, right? So I can have those kinds of system trade-offs in addition to the algorithm development and the system-level design. Now, in a lot of the cases that I showed here, we were actually fusing detections. So a new detection would come in from the sensor, and we'd take that detection and fuse it with something that we've already had in track. But in the case of a lot of the sensors that we have, whether they're on UAVs or vehicles, sometimes it's a black box, and the output of that sensor is actually a track. So again, remember I talked about track level fusion. And what we want to be able to do is take traps from multiple platforms and fuse them at the trap level, not just the detection level. And that's what I showed here. In this case, there's two vehicles with sensors on them, the blue vehicle and the red vehicle. And essentially, we're going to be able to fuse the traps generated from each of these guys. So vehicle one will be able to see what vehicle two sees, and vice versa. The scenario that's kind of interesting is, imagine vehicle one has this field of view that it sees with its camera and its radar. It generates an air picture of what's in front of, this, of the ego vehicle. It actually passes those on to vehicle two. By the way, vehicle two only sees the back of vehicle one. But its picture that it sees, its situational picture that it sees, is extended by sharing the tracks across there. And we're fusing those tracks at those different levels. Now the key thing is, eventually vehicle two will see what vehicle one saw, just at a delayed time, as it's moving in, right? So we're sharing that. It now knows what it sees. It knows what vehicle one sees. Eventually they both pass the pedestrian. And when they pass the pedestrian, it's important to be able to control rumors. In other words, vehicle one and vehicle two shouldn't be keeping that pedestrian in the system after neither of them actually see it. So we have a mechanism to prevent rumor control as they both gracefully pass the pedestrian. But you can see the value here. It also has a framework for things like V2X exploration, where the tracks are being passed between vehicles. It makes a nice testbed from that standpoint. But it also, you can see how it extends the view of the vehicle here. How many times have you seen, you know, a vehicle stop for a pedestrian crossing the road, and then you know, the car behind gets impatient and passes, right? This is the kind of future work that can prevent that kind of scenario. I talked about closing the loop, planning, deciding, planning, and acting, right? So in the case of the adaptive cruise control is a good example of that, right? The scenario is playing out in front of the vehicle, and we're trying to use that system to figure out what the car, what the autonomous system is going to do next, right? So here we have a closed loop system where we can actually figure out the speed of the vehicle, the ego vehicle, based on what it's seeing, the fused version of what it's seeing in the field of view. Okay, so take a look at what happens here. So we'll have the vehicle that's moving, and you can see the kind of this cone of the field of view of the sensors, and given how close it's coming to the cars in front of it, you can tell a lot of things are going to be happening here. And as they start approaching each other, what you'll see is that the speed of the ego vehicle can be adjusted in closed loop through control. So if you're focusing on controls, again, this is a good platform to work with your colleagues on in the sensor fusion, or sorry, the signal processing and image processing to create a common model across the team that can be that can bring the team together in that. And when you're done, you know, you can see, this may be hard to see a little bit, but basically the velocity, the acceleration, the distance can be maintained as a safe distance as the vehicle is coming together. Okay, so what I've shown here is enabled by this toolbox that we introduced in 2020, called Sensor Fusion and Tracking Toolbox. There's four major components to the tools. The sensor models and the scene generation tools to build up the cases that we review. The second case is the tracking algorithms, localization algorithms that are at the heart of what you want to do in the autonomous system. And for this, there's a range of capabilities to pick from the least computationally ones that you could put on the lowest set of hardware, all the way up through the highest performing ones that, again, you can make that trade based on the system that you're building. You need to be able to visualize the results and look at the metrics of how is it doing. And then in the case of either speed up or deployment, you want to be able to generate code through MATLAB Coder. I should mention, in the cases that I use autonomous driving as an example, well, I also use the automated driving toolbox to generate those scenes that you saw in the system. You know, you can see, hopefully you saw in the case where we actually are taking camera data, LiDAR data, radar data as a front end, that processing, signal processing and image processing create the detections, and then closing the loop with the control side to actually figure out, okay, what do I do next, right? The good news is there's a lot of resources to get started with. Our website has a lot of the information that I just mentioned here. We have a white paper. I have some copies of it at the booth, but we can send you a copy electronically as well. We also have a cheat sheet that sort of walks through some of the trade-offs that I mentioned, when you use a certain algorithm, how you get started in this area. And we're really excited that more recently we just introduced a series of tech talks that that go through sort of the basics of getting started with some of the tools here in MATLAB. So there's a five-part series here that I encourage you to take a look at. They're all about 10 or 12 minutes each, and they focus on various aspects. So it gives you a real good overview of the technology if you're new to it. Even if you've been there to some great some visualizations and connections to some of the tools that you can use as well. So I want to leave enough time for questions. I thank you for your time, and if we have time for a few questions.
We have questions.